Let's zip now through some local corporate stories. Dennis Uys Dito, Telecommunity renews its $1.18 billion loan with Chinese banks. The telco giant's parent firm said the Bank of China and the China Wensheng Banking Corporation extended a bridge facility. Now that facility will be repaid and absorbed via a $3.9 billion project financed long-term facility that is currently being finalized by Dito. For the energy arm of Ayala Corporation, ASEN, it is investing an additional 211 million pesos in a partner company for the development of a solar farm in Cagayan Province. ASEN said it will buy about 77,000 preferred shares of Nature's Renewable Energy Development Corporation. The latter will use the funds gained from that deal to finance the 133-megawatt solar power plant in Cagayan. And finally, renewable energy company FirstGen discloses its unit, Energy Development Corporation, will no longer pursue exploration and development activities in Peru, citing political and market factors. The Latin American country has been seeing violent weeks-long protests fueled by the impeachment and arrest of former President Pedro Castillo in December and deep dissatisfaction over living conditions and inequality in the country. The Makati Business Club urges lawmakers to pass the Ease of Paying Taxes Bill. The elite membership of Filipino businessmen says the measure will be a huge help for small and micro taxpayers. It adds it will also enable businesses to focus more time and effort on creating more and better jobs. The Senate Ways and Means Committee approved the bill on Monday. Senators are set to make amendments, which include simplifying tax returns and processes for micro and small taxpayers. The Philippine government's infrastructure spending dropped in March. The budget department said expenditures for infrastructure and other capital outlays fell to 83.7 billion pesos in March, or a 16% drop year on year. But it was still 33.5% higher than the 62.7 billion spent in February. The DBM attributed the higher spending to road and rail projects. RCBC's Michael Ricafort says easing inflation will support infrastructure growth in the coming months. The outflow for portfolio investments, for what's usually called hot money, continued for the third straight month in April. The net inflow of the short-term foreign funds last month was nearly at $352 million. That is higher than March's $70 million and is a reversal of the $1.4 billion net inflow in April of last year. RCBC's chief economist Michael Ricafort says easing inflation in the coming months, coupled with lower global crude oil prices, may lead to better hot money data. But he warns this may be offset by risks posed by the prolonged U.S. debt ceiling talks and hawkish signals from some Federal Reserve officials. The trade chiefs of the world's biggest economies exchanged barbs on trade, investments, and export policies. Thursday's meeting between U.S. Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo and her Chinese counterpart Wang Wentao was the first U.S.-China cabinet-level exchange in months. The U.S. Commerce Department called the discussions candid and substantive. It said Raimondo raised concerns about Beijing's actions against American companies operating in China. Her remarks after Beijing earlier this week banned the sales of U.S. chipmaker Micron's products to local industries. Washington previously objected to the move, calling China's move as baseless. Wang, meanwhile, brought forward complaints about U.S. policies towards China, including on semiconductors and export controls. But both sides agreed to maintain open communication lines to help navigate their relationship. Stocks in Asia capped the week in the green amid reports U.S. negotiators are closing in on a deal to resolve the debt ceiling impasse. The two sides are said to be looking at $70 billion in discretionary spending. But U.S. President Joe Biden insists he will not accept steep spending cuts.
Now, I want to be clear. And the negotiations we're having with Speaker McCarthy is about the outlines of what the budget will look like, not about default. It's about competing visions for America. Under my administration, we've already cut the deficit by $1.7 trillion in our first 2 years. But Speaker McCarthy and I have a very different view of who should bear the burden of additional efforts to get our fiscal house in order. I don't believe the whole burden should fall on the backs of middle class and working class Americans.
Markets in Asia are also reacting to a tech rally on Wall Street. Chip giant Nvidia fueled the rise in Nasdaq, with its shares jumping to a record high after a stellar revenue forecast. This brought its market value to just under $1 trillion, putting it close to joining the elite Wall Street club of tech giants. Now, taking a look at major stock indices in the region, the Nikkei 225 led Friday's gains, even as core inflation in the Japanese capital grew to its fastest pace since 1982. The Straits Times, though, continues its losing streak after Singapore's manufacturing output fell nearly 7% on year this April. Over in Europe, futures point to a higher open, with investors keeping a close watch on the debt ceiling talks stateside. In Wall Street, all three major indices are up, with the Nasdaq still leading in pre-market open. Now, trading resumes tonight, Manila time,